morning. And happy Father's Day. We're excited that you're here or you're out there. But the most important thing is that we're together worshiping God. And it's a delightful day. There is a bake sale right after church. So even if you're watching on Facebook Live, after church, come on over. And while you're here, come a little earlier, because today is also a congregational meeting directly after the worship service. We're going to be electing, voting on some upcoming deacons and elders, and we thank them for their leadership. So please join us if you are able to. And wanted to say I'm out of breath because I ran down the aisle. Actually, Morgan is getting married this next weekend, and she'll be walking down the aisle. So we're thinking of you this week. So, okay. Wanted to say too, Vacation Bible School is happening. We're going to be in person in the sanctuary as well as outdoor classrooms. It's not too late, but if you can sign up this week, we need to make sure we have the numbers, order the t-shirts. I have some lists outside the church office. If you want to volunteer, great. Just put your name down and your t-shirt size. We have about 70 kids this year, which might seem a little smaller, but I think this is the year people are finally, because it's post-pandemic, they're traveling, they're doing more swim meets. So we are just so thankful, though, to be in person, and we would love some extra help with the kickoff. We're doing a big hot dog kickoff, mini carnival, and a big barbecue at the end. So it's all coming up in July, but we need your help now. We also want to thank people that have signed up to help with the fireworks booth. We're joining teams with Briar Hill. There'll be a fireworks booth at the end of the month opening up. It's at Buffalo Wild Wings in East Dublin. If you've signed up, the list is still on the front of our church website. If you're interested in signing up for an additional shifts, come to me and I'll coordinate that with Briar Hill. But please tell your friends, that's the place to buy fireworks. It's a great fundraiser for the church. And that's what I'm going to say for now. I think Pastor Randy will say some more later on, but we're happy that you're here, and may God have something special to say to each and every one of you today.
Thank you, Dean. Thank you very much. today we're going to talk about transformation. We're going to be looking at an example of someone who was transformed. And I never really noticed this before in Genesis. I thought it was really interesting because we know Jacob as the deceiver, the trickster, the supplanter. And yet we talked a little bit a couple weeks ago about the fact that when he left the compound in which he had lived for so many years and the safety of that, and started to travel 500 miles to where his uncle lived. And just the change that occurs for him, and partly in that place that he stopped at, we talked 2 weeks ago, he met God. But we want to talk about transformation. So I don't know if anybody was here or who was here on Ash Wednesday, but Jerry, do you have that slide? So I don't know if you remember the money tree plan I had. When at Ash Wednesday, I chopped off the top of that. And I talked about how that, you know, we need to be able to grow, and sometimes we need to start over. And I put it in a carafe of water, and it sat on the filing cabinet in the office for 6 weeks, all the way through Easter, and it didn't grow one single root. So much for my illustration, right? So after I chopped it off, I put the planter in the choir room, and it was there for about 2 months. No water, no sun. I didn't go in and talk to it, didn't tell a bedtime story. And so I thought, you know, I really should move that out. And so I moved it back to my office. And this picture is of May 27th. May 27th, I had that little growth on it. And 3 weeks or 4 weeks later, no, is it 3 weeks? 3 weeks later, this is what I got. That's the same plant. What the heck? I'm supposed to be a great gardener. Maybe not. Yeah, keep my hands off. Exactly, Sandy. God does amazing things for us, transforms us, sometimes in unexpected ways. That plant did not root in that water. But even though this, I cut it off so I could start it lower, even though it didn't grow the way I wanted it to, it's even taller now. That's what God does for us. So we want to talk about transformation. And sometimes we forget that, but it's nature that reminds us of that transformation, just as I was reminded through this plant. So Psalm 19 says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech, they use not our words. No sound is heard from them, yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we just need to be able to give ourselves to you. We just need to be able to be nurtured by your word and by your community of faith, by your spirit. Then we'll grow. Yes, we need sometimes to do hard work, but sometimes we just need to be willing to receive what you have for us, your grace. Your grace will help us to grow in faith in you, and to become the people you've called us to be. Lord, help us to be that way today. We ask all this in your son's name. And everybody said, amen.
Amen. Thanks, Randy. It all starts with understanding who we are in God's eyes, how God views us, not how we view ourselves. And this song says it so well. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. I'm chosen. I'm not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me. Those things are the foundation on which we live and breathe. Let's stand together.
Who am I that the highest King should welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Verse.
Free at last, he has ransomed me. Oh, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Oh, he died for me. Who the Son sets free. Oh, it's free.
I am who you say I am. You are.
Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Instrumental.
Chosen, not forsaken, I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say.
Make this your statement today. I am chosen.
I am chosen. To the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord, who are all things so wondrously radiant, shelters the under His wings, earth virgin sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how all thy longings have been granted in what He ordaineth? Praise to the Lord, who all prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely His goodness and mercy may be attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do. Grant with His love He be friendly. Praise to the Lord, oh let all that is in me adore. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am.
Make this your part.
For me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen. For me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
So now it's time to pass the peace of Christ. Please greet each other with a handshake, a hug, or a high five, or a fist bump.
Ooh. Are you ready for a kid's message? Okay. All right. Get ready. Get ready, get ready. Is that correct? Can I do something?
If you need to sit, you don't need to sit and be good.
Ooh. You have to sit down.
Calling all kids, I see you out there. It's okay if he holds it too, it's fine. All right, calling all kids. And even if any middle schoolers want to come up, you are more than welcome to. All right. Have a seat right there. Okay, have a seat. Okay, so actually, Palmu, will you help me with this? Come on up. Come on up. Okay, come on, come on up. Do you have it this? Who has this at their house? Oh my gosh, you need to get this at your house. So, what are these used for? They're floaties. They're for little, well, yeah, I don't think this would help me float too much. They could, wait, why are you laughing at that, Sandy? Some people have water wings, and the water wings, what do? They help you float, right? It's a little safety for you. Or if you're right, if you're little, like let's do Nadia, why don't you come on up? Why don't you come up here? Come on. Let's see if this will fit Nadia. You got a pretty dress. Here we go. Let's find out. Here, Carolyn, you go over here. Let's see. Can I put this over you? Okay. I thought you liked it. Is that going to help? Oh, wait. Arm up. Arm up. Oh, gosh. I don't want to hurt her neck. Okay, here we go. Oh, does it fit? Okay. Now, come over here. Come over here. So, yes, thank you. Thank you. Photo opportunity. So these floaties, do you think if you're swimming, do you think that this would help you float in the water? Do you have one of these? She has one of these. Let me see if Daria can say something. Do you have one of these floaties?
Except it's a flamingo one.
It has a flamingo on it. Well, this is all I could find. Okay, so. All right, here's the big question. So these floaties are helping us, right?
Yeah.
And that started me thinking. Oh, here, do you want to hold this one too? You can hold that one too, okay? Here you go. All right, here's the question for you all. You ready? And I'm going to have you stand up here with me first. So these floaties help us in the water, right?
Yeah.
And sometimes they're called lifesavers. If they're really like big white ones for us adults, they'll help us. It started me thinking, it's Father's Day, right? How are our fathers lifesavers? How do they help us, cheer us up, help us up? What do they do that are really good things to help us? Do you want to answer how your father, your grandfather is a helper to you? Anyone here can answer that question. How are our dads, our uncles, fathers, helpers to us?
I gave my dad some presents.
You gave your dad some presents because you love him, right?
Yes.
But what does he do to help you? What does he do to help you? You told me earlier, does he make breakfasts?
Yeah.
Does he make really good breakfasts?
Yeah.
Awesome. Who else wants to share? Zach, or do you want to say, does your father play with you in the backyard?
My dad helps me get things that I make for him. I also make it for my mom.
That's wonderful. You make things for them and he helps you get them?
Mom.
Yes. Did your daddy help you? Does he play with you?
Yeah.
Dad plays with you?
Yeah. These new masks.
Oh, Dad bought them. They're new masks. Show them off. Awesome. Okay. Yes. How does your dad or grandpa help you? No answer is wrong. Turn around. There you go, John.
My dad helps me play Roblox.
Roblox. That's a cool dad. All right. Zachariah, does your dad make you breakfast?
He makes me pancakes.
Pancakes. Hey, that's a cute pancake coloring page. I chose that one today for you. Awesome. Anyone else want to share? I know for my dad, he taught me card games, and he taught me corny jokes. So sorry about that. That's where I get all the corny jokes. It's from my dad. Pomley, want to share anything? No? Okay. Well, we're going to be talking about how our dads, our grandfathers, our uncles, the important men in our life, they help us, and how that they should be adored today. So we're going to make them a special present. So we're going to have lots of fun. But I want us to remember that it's all possible because of our Heavenly Father God, who's created us all. And I think these water floats are a hit. So I got them at Dollar Store in case you're interested. But here's the thing. Zachariah, stand up. Hold on. Everyone look over here really quickly. Hi. Good to see you, Selena. Stand up here, Zachariah. Zachariah has something special in his pocket. Want to show us what it is? All the men at JKPC are going to be getting, what are they getting today? Hold on. What is it, a lifesaver?
A lifesaver.
Because our fathers are?
Our
lifesavers. That's right. So on the way out, men, we thank you for being here. We thank you for praying for these children, helping them in so many different ways. Yes, you can volunteer for Vacation Bible School. It's the best way to help out, too. And then, hold on, Pomley wants to say something. Uh-oh. Oh, you want the life. The lifesavers are for the adult males. They can share if they want. Okay, I'll give this to your, want to give this to your dad? Do not open it. All right, let's say a prayer. We'll have some more fun. Father God, we thank you for giving us important men in our life, our dads, grandfathers, uncles, neighbors, and all the men at JKPC. We are blessed to have them, and help us today to show our adoration and actually to show thanks every single day of the year. So Lord, let us be reminded that you are our Heavenly Father. We are all your children of God, no matter what our ages, and help us to please walk with your son Jesus and to do good things. We all said a huge amen. All right, PJ, he's going to give us to you. Go ahead, pound them all the way down. Let's take the floaties. I have Mrs. Richards helping me. We have middle school in room D, and there's a bake sale afterwards. Go ahead and take the float. You can.
Thank you, Nancy. Hope you all, you dads here, have a great Father's Day. Get to connect with your kids. I'm looking forward to that myself. Great song here that I think it's a radio song, so many of you probably know it or have heard it. Sandy knew it. I didn't know it. That's typical for us, right? But it reminds us that God came into our lives, and it's through his grace, as Randy mentioned earlier, that God has come in, changed our lives, and made us lights, made us the light for him here. So it's a great song. When the stars came crashing down in tiny pieces on the ground, I was all alone down here, trapped beneath the atmosphere, that I thought somebody called my name, and I spun around and I caught a flame. I gave into a God I didn't know, and now everything is falling into place. Brand new life is calling, and I owe it all to grace. And it's so much brighter living in your world, Savior, what you did for me. You gave me something I want everyone to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, 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 oh. I'm learning to be the light. Whoa, whoa, I'm learning to be the light. Whoa, whoa, heart is cold as ice. You can't melt it with advice. So no one wants to listen to a list of things you shouldn't do. So I build a city on a hill and I light a candle on my sill, knowing you'll be always knocking at your door. Oh God, I just want to love on everyone. All I have is yours to give, so let the people come. And it's so much better living in your world, Savior, what you did for me. Gave me something I want everyone to see. I want them to see it. 'Cause when we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, oh, I'm learning to be the light. Whoa, whoa, learning to be the light. Whoa, whoa, I'm learning to be the light that makes the shadows hide, the light that breaks the curse of pride, the light that takes the weary in his arms. When it all came crashing down, there was only darkness all around, but in the distance I could see a flame. And it's so much brighter living in your world, Savior, what you did for me. You gave me something I want everyone to see. When it's something, when it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, 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 I'm learning to be the light. Whoa, whoa, learning to be the light. Whoa, whoa, I'm learning to be the light. Whoa, whoa, I'm learning to be the light.
Good morning. Please listen to God's word, Genesis chapter 29, verses 1 to 12. It's on page 23 of your pew Bible. Then Jacob continued on his journey and came to the land of the eastern peoples. There he saw a well in the open country, with three flocks of sheep lying near it, because the flocks were watered from that well. The stone over the mouth of the well was large. Where all the flocks were gathered there, the shepherds would roll the stone away from the well's mouth and water the sheep. Then they would return the stone to its place over the mouth of the well. Jacob asked the shepherds, "My brothers, where are you from?" "We're from Haran," they replied. He said to them, "Do you know Laban, Nahor's grandson?" "Yes, we know him," they answered. Then Jacob asked them, "Is he well?" "Yes, he is," they said, "and here comes his daughter Rachel with the sheep." "Look," he said, "the sun is still high. It is not time for the flocks to be gathered. Water the sheep and then take them back to pasture." "We can't," they replied, "until all the flocks are gathered and the stone has been rolled away from the mouth of the well. Then we will water the sheep." While he was still talking with them, Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she was a shepherd. When Jacob saw Rachel, daughter of his uncle Laban, and Laban's sheep, he went over and rolled the stone away from the mouth of the well and watered his uncle's sheep. Then Jacob kissed Rachel and began to weep aloud. He had told Rachel that he was a relative of her father and a son of Rebekah. So she ran and told her father. May God bless this reading.
Thanks, Stan. Stan was doing such a good job, I asked him earlier if he wanted to read a few more verses, and he said no, 12 was fine. It's just the beginning of the story, really, and I'm talk a little about a little bit more of the story. But, you know, we're visiting Jacob again. I think, you know, we become so familiar with some of these passages that we just don't catch some of the nuances. And as well as, you know, I have the opportunity to find out what they are in Hebrew and get some of the flavor of the culture and so forth. And always, for me, it's just kind of enlightening. But before I begin, let's say a prayer. Lord Jesus, we come to you today thankful for this beautiful day we have, for a day to honor the men in our world, in our lives, a chance to celebrate other holidays, and just we give you thanks for the fact that we can breathe and we have life. But we continue to pray, Lord, for those that are suffering and dealing with tragedy and other concerns. But this morning, Lord, we're here to be attentive to your Spirit. We'd hear what you have to say to each and every one of us. Something probably different, but something that we need to know. Something that will help us to accept you, to receive your grace more fully. And so now, Lord, I ask that the words of my mouth, the meditations of our heart, will be acceptable to you. For you are a rock. You are a redeemer. Amen. Does anybody know what today is? Sunday. Nice. Thank you, Jim. Whose birthday? Garfield's birthday. Nice. I'm learning all kinds of things today. That's awesome. It was going to be when the Warriors took the championship, but that happened last Thursday, right? Yeah. Okay. I think there's a few Boston fans here too. Anyway, but you know what? Today is Father's Day. For those that didn't say that, it is Father's Day, just in case you need to know. It's also Juneteenth. Did you know that? It's also a day we're going to baptize someone in God's family. It's a day that we celebrate transformation. Now, I remember Father's Day in 2013 really well. I was blessed to have my children in the area, and they were all there. We had actually gone up and spread ashes of my father-in-law up near Pinecrest Lake, a place that he loved. And we were back in our house, and my son gave me a gift, and I opened it up, and it was a bib. But it said on the bib, "I love you, Grandpa." That was the day my son and my daughter-in-law revealed the fact that they were pregnant. And we were going to have our first grandchild. Very well etched in my mind. Lincoln Rose McGrady Beach. She'll know the alphabet by the time she writes her name. Juneteenth. I just learned this, actually just a few years ago. June 19th, 1965. That's the day the Union Army Major General Gordon Granger rode into Galveston, Texas, use all those G's, to tell the enslaved African Americans they were free. Now, the Emancipation Proclamation actually had been signed by Abraham Lincoln on January 1st, 1963, but they did not learn that in Texas at Galveston until Major General Gordon Granger rode in and let them know. I don't know if you know this, but last year that became a federal holiday, signed into law. And it's the first new federal holiday that we've had since 1983, when Martin Luther King Jr. Day became a federal holiday. And today, we will baptize Gary Allen as he publicly reaffirms his faith in Jesus Christ, his Lord and Savior. And it's something he wanted to share with our congregation. And so our elders have approved to have him baptized here in this place today. But today is also a day when we see in Genesis God's handiwork. And a man we've been following in Scripture who makes a drastic change in life. And I don't know if we really recognize it, if we really see it. At least for me, I didn't really see it at first. You know, we remember him as the trickster, as the deceiver, the supplanter. But he's also a father of our faith. How did he get from one to the other? It wasn't because he got cut off at the right place and watered. So remember, last week, or 2 weeks ago, we talked about this homebody, second-born tent dweller, decided he had to leave his family because his father was in pursuit of him because he had stolen his brother's birthright. His father had been tricked into blessing him. And so his mother makes up this story about needing to get a wife from her brother, Laban, 500 miles away. And so he's off to this new place, a place that he doesn't know, a man he's never met, venturing out of a compound. Perhaps he has walked out of a handful of times. Now, perhaps that was because he felt the urgency of maybe meeting his maker before he was ready. But he did it. And 2 weeks ago, we talked about the place that he stopped at. Remember, it was called a certain place. It wasn't just any place. It was a certain place. And later when he left it, he called it Bethel, which is house of God. It was at that place that God came beside him. Now, what's interesting, as it says in the scripture, and it says, then Jacob continued on his journey. Other translations said Jacob resumed on his journey. But you know, that word resumed is a phrase that's not used anywhere else in the Bible. And it actually means lifted up his feet. He didn't just continue on a journey, which he had set out to do. No, he lifted up his feet. He decided to get his feet moving in a direction. And I think he changed the direction he was going, even though it's still the same destination, but he changed the way he was going because God had come beside him. We learn that in Scripture that he comes to this place, and it's interesting, again, the only conversation or the only words about his trip is one, the place, certain place he stopped and the place he arrives. Now, I don't know about you, but 500 miles in car even takes a long time, let alone walking. But we hear nothing else about his journey because it's not important, except that he continued on. So it says, then he saw a well in the open country. A well. It was a few weeks ago we heard about a well when the servant of Abraham went to find a wife for his father, Isaac. For Jacob's father, Isaac. And where did he go? He went to a well. What happens at a well? Something refreshing, restoration. Something happens there that doesn't help out happen in the ordinary scheme of things on a daily basis. So he goes to this well. And there he meets these shepherds. Now, I don't know why it says three, but for some reason it says, in the open country, there are three flocks of sheep lying near the well. I don't even know how he could tell the different flocks of sheep. Were they different colors? How did he know there were three flocks? Maybe they had a designated area, you know. Sheep A's here, sheep B's here, sheep C's here. I don't know. But then he begins this conversation with shepherds, where these sheep are gathered. And he finds out that the well, which has a large stone on it, is not removed until all the flocks have been gathered. So even as we learn that the day is still in the middle of the day, I mean, I don't know if it's the designated time or not, but they aren't watering them yet. They're waiting. They're waiting to water. And then he asks them about Laban. And he says, first he finds out they're from Haran. And then he says, do you know Laban, Nahor's grandson? And yes, we know him. He said, is he well? Now, what's interesting is the word here is actually shalom. It's, does he have shalom? Does he have peace? Does he have wholeness? And they say, yes. In fact, here comes his daughter, Rachel, with the sheep. One thing that was just a little interest, sidebar, doesn't have a whole lot of meaning, but Rachel, by the way, means you. Now, I don't mean you. I mean E-W-E, female sheep. And other translations calls her a shepherdess. Anyway, so here comes Rachel, Laban's daughter. And so what's interesting is Jacob says, okay, well, I think what you guys ought to do, you ought to water your sheep and then take them off to the pasture. Kind of like before Rachel gets here. I mean, what was he thinking? Was he maybe seeing something, had some idea that maybe Rachel was someone he wanted to talk to alone, perhaps, or something? Well, they don't fall for it. They say, no, we can't do that. We're waiting for all the sheep to get here. So while he was still talking to them, Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she was a shepherd. He went over and rolled the stone away from the mouth of the well. He hadn't even had a conversation with her. He didn't reveal himself to her. He just goes ahead and goes over to where that stone is. Now remember, what was he before? He was a tent dweller. He rarely walked out of the compound. He was in there making food. He was a great chef, but he wasn't one that was lifting weights a lot, I don't think. And yet he decides he's going to go ahead and move that stone. Whew! Macho. Maybe. I don't know. I wonder if he had any Bengay for later. I don't know. But anyway, he goes ahead and moves the stone for Rachel so he can water the sheep. So he waters her sheep. And then he tells her who he is. He kissed her and began to weep aloud and told Rachel that he was a relative of her father, the son of Rebekah. So she ran and told her father. Well, the story goes on. We find out he's there for about a month, living there. Laban embraces him, and he starts doing something around for Laban. I don't know what it is, because it says in Scripture, it says, well, Laban says, why should you work for nothing? So he must have been doing something. And so Jacob, who has been actually, you know, captured by Rachel's presence, has fallen in love with her, and he makes the deal, okay? I'll work for you for 7 years if I can marry your daughter. Now, why does he need to work for 7 years? Well, partly because he has nothing to give Laban for this daughter. He has no dowry he can give to her. I mean, he has nothing he can get for her, okay? So he has to do something. So he says he'll work 7 years for her. And if you know the story, he works 7 years. And it says they go by like 7 days. He was so in love with her. And then it comes to the wedding. And they have their wedding. And the wedding night. And of course, she has the mask on. No COVID, but they had to wear masks then. And he wakes up the next morning and it's not Rachel. It's Leah. It's Rachel's older sister. He's not real happy. He goes and complains to Laban. You switched the brides on me. And Laban gives him this story about, well, in our custom, where we live, you get the older daughter has to be married before the younger daughter, and so you get to have the bonus. So he married, but you know what? Spend the week with Leah, and then when that marriage ceremony is over with, then you can marry Rachel, and then you get to work for me for another 7 years. Remember who this guy was? He stole a birthright. He stole a blessing. And he has agreed to end up working 14 years so he can marry the woman he loves. That's transformation. That's change. This is not what he sowed. I have in here, we reap what we sow. Sometimes we don't reap what we sow, and it's a good thing. But he had said he reaps the fact that even because of his deceit and chicanery, he meets God. He changes the sense of his direction. And he then finds ways in which he can go ahead and live out his life doing what he needs to do to get what he wants to get, which is, in this case, which is Rachel. Now, next week, we're going to talk about the fact that he will have, not only will he have two wives, but he'll have 12 boys that are born. He'll have all kinds of livestock. I mean, he just completely receives abundance of blessing. And so it reminded me that sometimes I don't act in a way in which I would want to reap what I sow. But the wonder is that God is there for us. God's grace helps us to grow when we least expect it, in some of the least expected ways. God longs to do this for us. The road we take may not always be down the path that God's chosen for us. But if we put our trust in God, if we come back to God to trust him, then he will bless us. A blessing beyond bountiful. Now, does this mean that we'll always land on our feet? We'll always reap a bountiful harvest in life? That there will be no difficulty in our lives? No, it does not. But what it does mean, what I do take away from this story and from Jacob's meanderings and connection with God, is that if we go ahead and change our direction with God and we move forward with God, then we will find new ways in which we can grow and we can become the people God's called us to be. I don't know what your situation is right now. It may be one that's filled with blessing. It may be one that's filled with trial. It may be one that you're really struggling. But the question for me is, are we willing to lean into God? Are we willing to follow God? We have the Father, a Father of faith, who acted so poorly at the beginning of his life, yet changed his direction, and then was blessed in a mighty way. I think it also says that there's no reason why we shouldn't ask for God to help us go through the difficult times we're going through, because God will be there for us, and God will bring us wholeness, God will bring us healing, God will bring us peace. It's God who will walk with us through the difficult times. It's God who will give us the grace we need when confronted with trials and tribulations. God will be there to rescue us. God will help us be transformed from what we are to what we can be. So let us receive the gift of God to become more than we ever thought we could. Let us receive his grace and embrace the changes we need to make in our lives to live in the freedom God has for us. And to God be the glory. Amen.
I need you, Jesus, come to my rescue. Where else can I go? No other name by which I am saved. Capture me with grace, I will follow.
Sing with us, would you?
My heart is yours. For life, I need your hand. In my no one else will do. And I put my trust in you. To Jesus, to my rescue. Where else can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. Capture me with grace, I will follow. I will follow you. I will follow you.
This world has nothing for me.
I will follow you.
This world has nothing for me.
I will follow you.
This world.
So as I mentioned, today is an exciting day for us in so many ways. Gary, if you would go ahead and join me up here. Gary was walking through the parking lot, a couple months ago. And he asked me if I was a pastor of this church. And I wasn't sure what he wanted to know that for. Yeah, he walks by here every day. But he said he's made a commitment. Long time ago, he was baptized, but he made a commitment and recommitted his life to Christ. And he just really wanted to have a sense of kind of putting a mark on the fact that he is a follower of Jesus. And so he wanted to know if we'd be willing to baptize him. And you know, what do you say? No, it's not going to happen. Yeah, so I'm so excited that you're willing to let us share that with you. We have Peter, who's our clerk of session, and in our denomination, our government, we require the session to approve of all baptisms. So Peter, if you would go ahead and present Gary for baptism.
On behalf of the session of John Knox, I present Gary Allen for baptism.
Thank you. And then I'm going to ask, we have some other session leaders. We have Sue Fox, who's our worship leader. She's going to come up and she's going to hold the bowl. And I have Kim Kraft, who's our outreach elder. And she's going to go ahead and hold the smaller pitcher. And then I'm going to have you over here. And then I have Bob Rickless. He's going to come over here. Bob. Bob is our property elder. So these are all elders of our church. And so what we do in our custom, our tradition here, is we have water both from the church faucets, and I made sure it was warm, and we water from home, because we know that we need a church community as well as fires at home to help us grow in our faith. And so Gary's brought water from his home, and that's what Kim has. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to go ahead and ask Gary these questions that we have to affirm the fact that Jesus Christ is his Lord and Savior and that he wants to be baptized. So Gary, these are really tough questions, you know. I've already shared them with you. So Jerry, if you have those, do you affirm Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? If so, please say, I do.
Yes, I do.
Thank you. Do you renounce evil and will you strive to follow the way of Jesus as you journey through this world? So,
yes, I do.
Thank you. Do you wish to be baptized?
Yes, I do.
Perfect. Now, we do not do baptism out on the street, just one-on-one. We do it as a community of faith. And so you may not know Gary very well. You'll see him if you get here early, walk across the parking lot. But it's still our responsibility, I believe, to pray for those that come to us to ask to be baptized. So a congregation, do you, as a people of this faith community, promise to encourage and pray for Gary Allen, as he strives to be a follower of Jesus? If so, please say, we do.
Amen.
Perfect. Awesome. So we're going to go ahead and pour a little bit of this water into this bowl. Together. Yes, together at the same time. Ready, go. Good job. Okay, that's great. That's perfect. How you doing, Sue?
Good.
Okay. And we're going to bless this water, Gary. We're going to say, so if you would pray with me for just a minute. Lord God, we ask you to bless this water. Water has been so a major part of our faith journey. I mean, Jesus met the woman at the well who became the first missionary. The Israelites passed through the waters that were parted for Moses to leave slavery, to come into freedom. Water has been restoration. It cleanses us. It refreshes us. It restores us. So Lord, we ask you to bless this water. Now, as we go ahead and we use it to baptize Gary, we thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for Jesus who said, I am the living water. We thank you for this water as a symbol of your Spirit. And may be blessed to again remind us of the gift we've received through your grace. In your Son's name, amen. So Gary, go ahead and come down here, and I'm going to ask you to kneel. And so now, Lord, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Please pray with me. Lord God, we have baptized Gary in your name. We baptized him knowing that he strongly desires to follow you, to be your son in this world. Continue to encourage him, to inspire him, to find new ways in which he can grow in his faith, that he can be in a model, just as other men are models for us, of what it means to walk through this world following you, following your steps, helping those in need, helping those who are hurting, being encouraging, as well as receiving grace from those around him who desire to lift him up as well. Lord, we ask you, in your son's name, we pray this. And everybody said, amen. Gary, thank you. If you would stand up, please. And what Gary's going to do, something we haven't done before. Gary's going to just hold this bowl with water. Where's Dean? I need you over here. We are going to remember our baptism today. Luther said that whenever you're really struggling with evil or the devil or Satan or you're struggling with issues, remember your baptism. So he says, remember your baptism, because that's the time when you've been renewed, restored, refreshed, and that baptism never leaves you. No matter how much you think God has left you, God is with you. So Dean, remember your baptism. People, remember your baptism. I told you to wear waterproof clothes today. Remember your baptism today. Gary, thank you. Remember your baptism. God is there for you. God is there with you. God is there to guide you, to celebrate with you. Remember your baptism. Remember your baptism. Remember your baptism. Remember your baptism. If you got missed, you can come up later. So, thank you. Blessings. Blessings to you. Thank you. You can go back to your seats now. Thank you so much. I think it's good for us every once in a while just to remember what it means to embrace the faith that God has given us. You know, we have a tendency to think, you know, we made that decision, which is, you know, we have made that decision, but it's been at the invitation of God. It's been paved the way through the death of Jesus Christ. And it's the continued accompaniment of the Holy Spirit that helps us not only to receive that grace, not only to hold on to that grace, but to share it with those around us. So today, I'm going to go ahead and do a pastoral prayer, and we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. Let us spend some time in prayer. Most Holy God, we come to you today being reminded of transformation, of unexpected growth, of a change from being a deceiver, an addict, a betrayer, perhaps a gossip, perhaps stealing time from people. Lord God, we come to be the people you've called us to be. We're just to be the people that share the light, as Dean sang earlier, that share the love, share the message of good news. And so, Lord, amidst of this, we pray. We pray for those who remember, who are struggling physically. We pray for the Mitchells. We pray for the Coakleys. We pray for the Smiths. We pray for Howard Lim, for Beth Brizzy. We pray for all those who are going through treatments. We pray for my daughter-in-law, Jessica. Pray you'll bring them back to wholeness, to restoration. Again, we need to remember that being healed is not the same as being cured. Healing is our soul. It's our outlook on life. It's our sense of grace and peace. It's our sense of joy. So we pray for those that are struggling with that. Lord, we ask you to be with those that are in the midst of transition, whether it be finding a new place to live, finding a new job, to work, developing a new relationship. Lord Jesus, you are the God, you're the right hand of God the Father. You are over all. that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that you are indeed our Savior and Lord. So Lord, we pray for those that are going through that hard time, that transition time. Lord, we pray for those who are celebrating. Yesterday, Lord, I was in Davis celebrating the life of Eric Mukherjee's father. We ask you to be with that family as they continue to mourn the loss. He died in September, but we had the celebration of life yesterday. Just give them a sense of your grace and peace. And thank you for the man that he was and continues to be in their lives. Lord Jesus, we come to you full of gratitude. Full of gratitude for bringing us to a place where we can worship you freely, where we can celebrate you wholeheartedly, where we can leave peacefully. We pray that we continue to do that here at John Knox. Most of all, God, I just pray that the good message that we received, that what the Spirit lets us know, that gives us a sense of liveliness, will also give us a sense of urgency to be able to share that good news with those around us. It may not be in talking, may not even be in acting, doing something. It could just be our presence. But help us to be the people you called us to be and share that good news with those around us. So we affirm again, Lord, that we indeed seek to follow you. And in that vein, we say that prayer which you taught your disciples. It begins, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil and the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We are God's people. We are God's loved ones, the bride of Christ. Those are the songs, the words we're going to sing as we go out today. And Randy, thanks for reminding me of that song we sang. There's a line in there, just the guy says, I just want to love on everyone. And I used to think, oh, that's so sappy. But it's really true. I really do. I just want to love on everyone, and I hope you do too. Let's stand together. We are God's people.
We are God's people, the bride of Christ the Lord.
I'm going to say go in peace, but if you're going to be part of the congregation meeting, you need to stay. Okay. But after that, go in peace. Have courage. Hold on to that which is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord while rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. All God's people said, amen. Don't forget, there's a bake sale to help fund the youth program. So take part of that too.